Hi, everybody, and welcome to our Exploring English Food and Culture Facebook Live. I'm joined by Claire and Chris. Hello to both of you.
Hi, Neil. Hi, everyone.
Hello.
And we're here for the next 30 or 40 minutes to talk about one of my favourite subjects, food, especially since it's lunchtime here just now and I haven't had mine yet. And to answer any of your questions, to talk about our free online course that Claire will tell you about in a moment, and to hear about food in your country and everything else. So anything you want to ask, anything you want to know, anything you want to tell us about food, just pop it into the comments. But first, Claire, tell us about the course.
So it's called Exploring English Food and Culture, and it's a way to learn about the food that we like to eat in the UK and to learn English at the same time. Every week there are recipes, cooking videos, and everyone on the course is sharing food and recipes from all over the world.
Okay. What are some of the best, what are some of the things you mentioned about food? What are some of the things that people can do on the course? Like specifically, what are some of the things
they can cook chicken tikka masala, can't they, Neil? So they can watch you and Tina and Sally doing cooking demonstrations. Mm-hmm. There are vocab quizzes about food words and phrases in English. There's reading about the history of different dishes. I mean, it's just got everything.
Yeah, so we want you to learn about food in the UK, and by talking about food, to learn a little bit about life in the UK. How do people live in the UK? What is everyday life like? And food is a big part of everyday life. So the course lets you learn English, find out about the UK, but also find out about food all over the world, because people on the course are sharing recipes, sharing their favorite food, sharing pictures of their breakfast and their favorite food. So it's about the UK, it's about the world, it's about food, and it's about English.
Mm-hmm. And we're going to be asking all the people that are watching some questions in a little bit as well. As well as answering questions, so we'll see how that goes. I'm very jealous of Mohammed Barakat, who at the moment is home eating lunch.
What are you having for lunch, Mohammed?
Yeah, what are you having, Mohammed? Something tasty.
Okay, so let's get started. We've got people from all over joining us. I've been popping some of them up on the screen. You've seen all the different countries that we've got. Food never fails me. Me too. Me too. I can always depend on food. Okay. And from Turkey as well, lots of countries there. Okay. So let's begin with a nice simple question to ask both of you, Claire and Chris, and our audience as well. So this course is about exploring food and culture, and as you both said, learning what people like to eat in the UK and learning how to cook some things like that, and learning about all the different types of food that there are there. This is a very difficult question, but you are only allowed one word. What one word would you use to describe food in the UK? Chris?
I'll go first. Okay, because the question says food in the UK. Mm-hmm. So my one word is diverse, because in the UK, you can find food from all over the world. You know, not only in London. So in London, you can find a restaurant from any country in the world that you want to. But not only in London, around the country, you have lots and lots of food choices. You know, so you can have Chinese food, or, you know, South Asian food, Indian, Bangladeshi, Pakistani food. Italian food is everywhere. So, you know, when people think about British food, then they might think of particular things that are traditional British dishes. But actually, food in the UK is fabulously diverse. You can find anything.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that was Chris's word, diverse. For all the people who are watching, whatever country you're in, wherever you're from, whether you've been to the UK or whether you've only seen British food or UK food on TV or in films, tell us what one word comes to your mind. What one word do you think of when people say food in the UK? Chris's was diverse. Claire, what's yours?
Mine is surprising.
Okay.
Because I think that's true of people who are on the course, because they find out like what Chris has said, it's actually more varied and more international than you think. But also because we have some surprising words for food and some things that sound like one type of food, but it's something else. And then things like bubble and squeak that, you know, who knows, who can guess what that is? But that's a type of food that we eat in the UK.
Mm-hmm. Juanice has stolen my word, which was delicious, because I love all food in the UK.
That's not just in the UK, is it, Neil?
No, that's true. I've never visited a country where I didn't love all the food, to be honest. Yes, you can tell.
Somebody said greasy. There were some nice answers in the...
Hold on, just coming
tasty.
In now.
Let's see.
Hold on. I can't find that one. Okay, amazing. Lots of people are putting putting examples of British food. Shepherd's pie is in there. Fish and chips is there. Actually, I like Melinda's one word here because, you know, potato is really important, but Melinda said cheese. And it's very true. There's a lot of cheese in a lot of things. Okay. Tasty.
Yep.
Okay. I still haven't found the greasy one. That's unfortunate. Okay. Never mind. Okay. Well, we're going to talk lots more about food, so we'll get through some other things in this. But the next question for everyone watching, tell us in the comments, what's the nicest thing you've eaten this week? Okay, we're on Thursday now. So, you know, you've had what, 4 or 5 lunches, 4 or 5 dinners this week already. Perhaps that's just me. What's the nicest thing you've eaten? Or maybe it was a snack. Maybe it was a sweet, something like that. Okay, what's the nicest thing you've eaten this week? Tell us in the comments. Claire, what about for you?
I'm distracted because I've just seen the word Scotch eggs in the comments.
Egg as well, and thought.
And I thought, someone's favourite thing they've had all week?
I'll come to these in a minute, because when I show these, the question disappears. So I'll put these up in a second. Mm-hmm. But let's start. So Claire, what's the nicest thing you've eaten this week?
Apple crumble. I made an apple crumble like the one that Tina makes on the course, but I put brandy in mine and hazelnuts, and it was delicious.
Okay. I've never tried that. Okay. I guess I'm too conservative with my apple crumble. It's just perhaps sultanas. but I haven't tried hazelnuts or brandy. Okay. Chris, what about for you?
I had some delicious borscht this week. Some Ukrainian friends made a lovely borscht for me and a bunch of friends in a garden. And it was a beautiful meal in a beautiful setting. And I love borscht, but I won't get into the argument about where borscht comes from.
Yeah, no, I love borscht too. I love Ukrainian borscht, absolutely. I also love, you know, the Polish clear borscht.
Yeah,
it's just I could eat that every day and never get tired of it as well. Both of them are just delicious. Okay, lots of answers coming in now, so let me bring them all up, and we'll see. Oh, there's so many. It's going to go really fast. Belal Nassar, homemade escalop. That sounds delicious. What kind of meat was it? Was it chicken or that, I guess? Okay.
Clafoutis.
Oh God, they're coming in so fast that I can't keep up. Rashi Express. I had bread toast. My mom made it.
Okay. Nice.
Camila Albuquerque. I've eaten a corn cake. I've never tried a corn cake. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about that in the comments, or maybe even share a link to a recipe or something, because I don't know what a corn cake is, so that would be great. Lamb rice mandi. Hold on. Getting there a bit. Sorry. Homemade cake from Rashi Express as well.
Yeah.
They're moving so fast when I try to click on them, they're going past. Mango and jackfruit. Okay. Hold on.
Which is jackfruit?
It's a really big spiky one, isn't it? And when you open it up, it's got lots of mini, they look like oranges inside.
It looks a bit like durian that we're going to talk about later, really, doesn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah. Beef burger, and it was amazing and delicious. Lots of cheese, mushrooms, and sauce. I have really made a strategic mistake here by not eating my lunch before this broadcast. Terrible. Especially because M. Baig's talking about biryani, one of my all-time favorite foods.
Love biryani.
Okay. There are so many. Couscous with fish.
With fish.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Roast yak.
Asado here in Argentina. Oh. Spaghetti with tomato sauce and prawns.
Asado.
Grilled chicken. Lots of delicious meals up here.
Yeah, Carolina's in North Macedonia, and I went to North Macedonia, and the food was excellent.
Mm-hmm.
This is great, looking at all of these.
Tunisian traditional dish, kefti.
Got moulkhia with chicken from Mutan Taman as well. That's one of my favourites.
Oh, a clafouti cherry cake.
Fantastic.
Great. Lots of ones here. Oh, I had this last week as well. That's good. I'll just put up. I had that on Sunday. Pastor tacos.
What is it? What's pastor?
I don't know what that is.
It's pork, especially marinated and cooked. There's a great Mexican place here that has that run by a Mexican family. That's really good and delicious. Watermelon and strawberries. Okay, heard enough. It's getting too much for me at this point. So these are all delicious. Pasta, what else? Oh, that sounds interesting. I haven't tried this. From Baguio City in the Philippines, purple yam. Called ube. Purple yam.
Yam jam.
Have you seen Katarina's answer about the chocolate and chicken?
No, I haven't got to that one yet. There's so many. Kelly's been trying UK food. I've just tried bangers and mash served by my friend. Not so bad, actually. I'm not convinced, but at least I'm still breathing. Yeah, that's not the enthusiasm I would hope for there. But
Kelly,
okay.
It sounds like you're expecting the worst.
Yeah.
Shall we explain to people what bangers and mash are for people that don't
know? All right, yeah, sorry. Bangers are sausages, and mash is mashed potato. So a very traditional British thing to eat, bangers and mash.
Usually with like some
gravy.
Onions gravy, and gravy, yeah, as well. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. I heard you mention this one earlier, Chris. Roast yak, a rare specialty from northern Pakistan.
Wow.
That sounds very interesting. And Bilu has a question for us. Do you eat couscous? Absolutely.
Yes.
I love couscous. Yeah. How about you?
Yeah. Yep. I make a veggie one with chickpeas and peppers. Yeah, I love it.
I usually just make roasted one with roasted vegetables, and that's it. And it's so quick, so easy, and so delicious.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh wow.
Okay.
Ketchup puri. We could just
so many. We could just spend all day just listening to people's food here, and I would never get bored. But I guess for the people watching, we should probably move on to another topic now. Okay. Actually, I have prepared something that I think. Might be interesting, but we've all talked about the best, the most delicious food we had this week. Before we started today, we were looking at a website that talked about the 21 most hated food in the world. And I thought it'd be interesting just to know, because, you know, some people love something, some people really don't like them. So we're going to ask you, everyone watching, and us as well, we're going to talk about some of these. And I'm going to begin with something that is very British. What does this picture show, Claire?
It's Marmite on toast.
tell us more. So, there you go. Look, that was really quick. Caro or Charo is definitely with the Scotch egg
Caro,
and the Marmite.
Yeah, Caro has got it.
Very, very knowledgeable on British food here. So, yeah, Marmite, what is it?
So Marmite's in the jar, and it's mm-hmm. a yeast extract, and I believe it was discovered through the brewing industry. So it was what was left at the bottom of the vats after they've made beer, I think. But it's very healthy. It's full of B vitamins, and it's very salty and savoury. So you don't need much. We usually have it on toast with butter.
With butter?
Yeah.
When you say we, you're not including me in that because
that was the royal
I really
we.
Don't like
that was the royal we.
I can't even smell it, let alone
okay,
eat it.
Okay, I love. So I'm going to answer this question. Yuck or yum? For me, it's yum.
Okay, so yum is something we say when something's really good. Yummy, yum, yuck is something we say when something tastes horrible. Chris, Marmite, yuck or yum?
Yum. I mean, maybe not as much as Claire, but it's really nice. It's lovely on toast, no butter, but it's really salty and so a kind of breakfast time.
Anytime. Day or night, I can eat it.
You're both very strange people. Okay. Let's move on to another one then. Well, I'm not going to... you can tell us in the comments if you've tasted Marmite, or in Australia and other countries, they have Vegemite, which is basically the same kind of thing. If you've tasted that, tell us in the comments, yuck, I don't like it, or yum, I like it. Okay?
Well, Shireen in the comment is recommending Marmite with porridge. It's rice porridge.
Marmite with porridge. Okay.
Rice porridge, so sort of, what do you call it, congee.
Where am I missing? Ah, there we go. Yes.
We're getting some yucks.
There's some good answers there. Yeah. And acquired taste.
I'm not doing well at convincing people that it's delicious.
I think that's an excellent expression there, what Shireen said. It's an acquired taste. How would you describe an acquired taste, Claire?
It's something that you don't like at first, but when you try it again and maybe for a third or fourth time, you learn to like it. That's what I understand.
Yeah, you learn to like it, yeah.
And we were speaking earlier about as you get older as well, your tastes change, don't they? I mean, there were things I hated when I was a kid that I love now. Are there any like that for you, Chris?
Well, I think olives, really. It's things that I didn't, when I was young, I didn't like olives. And now I don't love them, but they're definitely yum, not yuck. So olives, I think, are an acquired taste.
Australians like their Vegemite. Yep. Mm. Yeah, I'm definitely not a Marmite fan. Okay, let's move on to the next one. I don't know if we have anyone from Italy watching, but this is always a very controversial one. Pineapple on pizza, a Hawaii pizza, ham and pineapple. Again, I'm sounding like the negative person here, but along with Marmite, that would be in my yuck column. How about for you, Chris?
Look, I lived in Italy for some time, but I'm liberal about these things. If you want to put pineapple on a pizza, then put pineapple on a pizza.
Yeah.
You know, in Italy, I've seen people put chips on a pizza. I've seen people put chocolate on a pizza base. So anything goes.
Mm-hmm. Clear?
Yum. I love pineapple on pizza, but I don't want the ham, thank you. I'll just have the pineapple and tomato sauce.
I'm in the wrong group here, obviously. I'm a pizza purist. You know, it's no. If people want to eat pineapple on pizza, go ahead, absolutely, but just don't give it to me.
So well, there you go. Katerina says she loves Hawaiian pizza, so...
From the bottom of my heart, she said.
There you go.
Best taste ever. Well, obviously, you know, this is. That's why we're doing this, though. There's lots of different people. We've got yucks and yums coming in. Look, there we go. I guess Garcia is definitely a yuck there. And there's some more. Let's move on.
A lot of yum.
To one that Chris mentioned already, olives.
Okay.
See, this one for me, it was strange for me to imagine that anyone doesn't like olives, because I don't think I could live without olives. I mean, I there's one thing I always have in the cupboard or in the fridge is a selection of olives. I love olives. Claire?
Yum.
Yum. Okay. This could be one we all agree on, perhaps.
Which do you prefer, green or the dark black olives?
Green. I like green when they're lemony and hard.
Mm-hmm. I like the ones that are kind of in the middle there, at the front, kind of, you know, reddish, darkish kind of Kalamata type ones or something that are...
They're good too.
Yeah, that are not quite black yet, but are just really nice. Be my favorite. So let us know in the comments how you feel about olives. Do you know anyone that really hates olives or really doesn't like them?
I mean, I mean, I'm not crazy about them. They're okay, but you know.
Okay.
I didn't used to like them, like you, Neil. Yeah. I think I grew to like them.
Okay, hold on. I just have to get a comment here. They're moving by so fast; it's hard for me to keep up with everything, and my mouse is not working properly for scrolling. What is going on?
Katerina hates olives.
Yeah, Katerina is making me laugh. The English eat olives in horrendous amounts.
Horrendous amounts. Okay. BB says, stop eating pizza, it fattens your butt. Well, thank you for that, BB. Mariana loves olives. Okay, we had that one already. What's this one? Okay. Yeah, this is the one you were talking about, Katarzyna, saying, hate olives. I had to sell them in Carluccio's. The English just eat them in horrendous amounts. Yes, you never want to see me out of an evening then, because yes, you're right. I would eat, you know, enough olives to sink a ship, possibly. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Now, this is one that not everyone may have come across, but many people will. What's this, Claire?
I thought somebody might type it in the comment before I could say it. It's
maybe they will.
That you find in Southeast Asia with a very distinctive appearance.
And more
smell.
Than appearance, very distinctive.
Very
smell.
Famous for its smell, yes.
Smelly.
No one said anything yet. Maybe it'll pop up in a moment. Are these
the
same?
Olive.
That's a good question.
Okay.
Hold on. That's not a question. Hold on. let me get rid of that.
Darren's got it.
These the same olives in different colors? Goodboy was asking. I think there was actually two types there. But yes, in general, olives, green and black olives, are the same olives, just at different stages of their growth.
Yeah, Shireen from Malaysia recognizes this as well.
Right. Yeah, Darren has got it in there.
And
durian. Yeah. And Mikala Gunaratne, mouth-watering durian from Sri Lanka. So this is one of the ones that's really interesting. I think we've all had it. And as we said, the thing about durian is it smells terrible. I remember when I used to live in Asia, hotels, every place, they all had like signs in the lift saying no durian allowed and signs on the door, you weren't allowed to bring them into the building. But what about the taste?
I'm not sure that I've ever tasted it. I remember the smell from my time in, you know, in Hong Kong and other places in Asia. I remember the smell very clearly, but the taste not so clearly.
Clear?
Yum, but only if you hold your nose.
Exactly. Same for me. It's really delicious. Absolutely delicious. But the smell takes a lot of getting used to. And I love... Yeah.
You see Shireen in the comments saying it smells like heaven and it tastes like hell? Oh, sorry, the other way around. It tastes like hell and it smells like hell.
What does it smell like, Caro? How would you describe the smell, Neil?
Like something's died.
Yeah,
I think it's quite socky.
Like a sock.
A smelly sock.
Yeah.
Maybe. It's quite, yeah, it's really, really unpleasant. Like this one's got a lot of people. People love it, though. There's only been one or two people have said. Jian Dao saying durian pillows is my favorite. I'm not sure if what you mean. Is that a special type of food or is it the name for the parts inside the durian? Maybe you can tell us a little bit more about that.
Especially if you're burping. There's some great comments today. Thank you.
Great comments.
Yourself being the opposite of everyone else. Never eaten it, but I like the smell. So that's
interesting.
Yeah, Shireen's saying they're in season. Looks like Katarzyna saying looks like dragon's egg. Yeah, it is. They're really interesting to look at, these fruits. But yeah, generally, overall, we've got a big majority of yum for durians. And as you said, I finally got to that comment from Shireen: smells like hell, but tastes like heaven.
Yeah.
Is it a hedgehog?
A clothes peg is essential.
It does kind of look like a living thing. You're right. Things like that. Okay. We're back to pizza again. And Luigi's just saying, I prefer pizza with gorgonzola. I love gorgonzola. So, yes.
Well, Luigi Tretti sounds like an Italian name. So, okay.
Sounds like he knows.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. And yet we've got a smelly sock there as well, as you were saying. Okay. So many comments on durian. I'm going to have to read these a bit later because we've got one more to get through here. Let's ask again. Do you know the people who are watching? Do you know the name for this vegetable? We can talk about it a little without naming it first. Do you eat this often, Chris?
Not often. I mean, most people in this country only eat this once a year, at a particular time of year.
Mm-hmm.
People are getting it now.
Yeah,
so it's usually at Christmas.
Yeah. Snejana said Brussels sprouts, exactly. And Shireen as well, Brussels sprouts. Uh-huh. And, you know, we have to ask the question again, of course. Yuck or yum? Claire?
Yuck. I have one a year on Christmas Day, and it's the smallest one in the pan.
I don't even pretend. I stopped pretending about 10 years ago or more. I don't even have the one. I just no.
You're wrong. You're both wrong.
No, they're terrible. terrible vegetable.
Definitely yum. I love them. They're and it's a shame that we only eat them at Christmas usually. They're really good for you. They've got lots of iron in them, I think. So they're very healthy. And yeah, you can pan fry them with a little bit of bacon or something, and they're really, really good, really tasty. So Brussels sprouts, they're not just for Christmas.
I'm sure they're very healthy, but the smell and the taste, I just don't like at all. How do you cook them, Chris?
At Christmas?
Yeah.
Then you take the leaves off, you put a cross in the bottom so that the water, the steam can get right to the center, and then we steam them. You know, so over boiling water, just so that they get lightly cooked. But if you fry them with a little bit of bacon or something, then they're delicious as well.
Mm-hmm. Got a fan here from Karotik. Lovely when sautéed in a wok. I'll take your word for that.
Yeah. No, that's what I'm talking about. And Anna Sylvia is saying the same thing, that you can fry them with butter.
With butter, delicious.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I like Adil's comment here. Served at school dinner at Christmas makes you run for the exit door.
Agreed.
Yes. No, many things would make me miss Christmas dinner, but yeah, that might be
right. Adil, you were eating yak earlier. You can eat Brussels sprouts. If you can eat yak, then you can enjoy Brussels sprouts.
Okay, well that was great. That was a lot of fun. It was great. I mean, it's really nice to hear from everyone about what you like and what you don't like. And yeah, we got a good spread there, I think. Before I move on, we have some tips from Darren Tay on Brussels sprouts cooking, who's saying trim the bottom, slice each in half top to bottom, heat the oil in a cast iron pan over a medium heat, put them cut side down, one layer at a pan, put in garlic. Sprinkle with salt and pepper, cook undisturbed until they begin to brown on the bottom and transfer to the oven. Great. Thank you for that, Darren. That's a whole recipe there, beautifully described, and it does actually sound quite good, I have to admit.
My mouth is literally watering reading this.
So if you want to try Darren's special Brussels sprouts, just find his recipe in the comments and give it a try. It sounds actually, even I might be able to manage a Brussels sprout cooked that way. Okay, let's move on. So on the course, we cover all these topics, lots of different things. We look at lots of different types of food, different celebrations, different recipes, everything like that. If you have any questions about food, about British food, or about anything to do with the language of food, let us know. Just ask in the comments now. We're going to look at a couple of questions that people have been asking on the course. And let's begin with this first one from Vanessa. This one's urgent because Vanessa will be in London in July, so only a week away. What food would you suggest? Okay, so Claire and Chris, let's imagine somebody is going to London just for the weekend, okay? And they have to try one thing that you say, really, you know, your journey, your trip will not be complete if you haven't tried this one thing. I'll let you do two things because you can do one perhaps with meat and one vegetarian, just to be for that. What would it be, Chris?
Well, it's difficult because I think if I don't know where you are now, Vanessa, so I don't know where you're coming to London from, but I guess it's the obvious answer, but I guess we have to say fish and chips. That is probably what most people think of when they think of British food. So take away fish and chips, so you don't have to go into a restaurant. You buy them in the fish and chip shop and then go and sit in a park with the paper, and pigeons and seagulls will come and steal your chips from you. But I think that's the traditional bit. And if you're going to do it really traditionally British, it will be raining as well while you do that. So you'll be sitting in a park in the rain eating fish and chips.
So plan ahead.
I'm not sure if we can organize that. But yeah, okay. The only thing I would say about fish and chips, and let me know if you agree or not, but they vary such an amount. You know, they go from really bad to absolutely the best thing in the world.
Yeah, it's difficult to find a really good one.
So I would check online, check some reviews or something, or, you know, like TripAdvisor or something, or Google, you know, reviews or something, and check what people say about them, because finding a good fish and chip shop is something, you know, when you find one, you go back again and again and again. Okay.
Can I check my answer? I've just seen a suggestion from Katarzyna. No, sorry. Okay, go on, Claire, your turn.
Claire, what's your...
It's really hard. Sunday roast, I think. Ideally, get yourself invited to a family home. That could be difficult. So find a pub with good reviews, good pub food, maybe a really old atmospheric pub. Go on a Sunday and order Sunday roast, the meat of your choice, probably beef. And roast vegetables, roast potatoes, lots of gravy, and there's always a veggie option as well. Mm.
And that's the thing about Sunday roast for me, is like the best thing about it is all the stuff that goes with it. So
yeah,
it's not that big a deal if it doesn't have the meat. It's like, you know, everything else is so good. It's just, you know, it's great. Okay.
Gina suggested a full English breakfast as well, which is the other thing, I guess, that, you know, a big cooked English breakfast.
Yeah. I mean, because it's only London and rather the UK, if someone was going to Scotland, obviously I would say they have to try haggis. But in London...
Luckily, they're not. So that was a good escape for Vanessa.
There's nothing lucky about that. But yeah, I mean, fish and chips, Sunday roast, you've kind of covered all the things. I don't know if I can think of something else that's peculiar to London.
What about afternoon tea?
Maybe. Actually, one thing that I would try is something that I miss very much, because you can't get it here and I haven't had one for years, is strawberry tarts. I love a strawberry tart. You're not a strawberry tart fan?
I can't believe that you can't get it where you are.
Not at all. Nothing even close.
Make them.
I'm not big on... I like cooking, but I'm not great at baking. But strawberry tarts, which is basically a pastry base with cream and then a big strawberry in it and a kind of strawberry sauce over the top. That's just so summery to me, so delicious.
I mean, strawberries is just summer to me. That's summer in the UK. So, Vanessa, buy some strawberries and just eat them as they are. Delicious. English strawberries.
About this today? Okay. One more question here, then I'm going to quickly move on to the question, because we've got lots of questions coming in from people here. But Yumi asked a really good question, which is, I'm interested in the decoration of birthday cakes in the UK. This is a good point, because that's something else that where I am, I don't know where you are, Claire, or anything, but here birthday cakes are totally different from what they're like in the UK, and it's very hard to find one that's like what Yumi's describing here. So Yumi's question is it common to decorate the cake with marzipan and buttercream icing, like in a picture? Claire?
I would say it's always decorated in various degrees of expertise, but I'd say it's always decorated with a lot of love. So a mum would make it for her kids, maybe a dad would make it for his kids, but it could be icing. What's it called? The icing, like icing sugar, that's quite hard. Or you get icing you can roll, can't you? Royal icing. But it usually would have a name on it, the child's name and their age, happy birthday, and maybe something that's to do with their interests. So a child that likes football, it would be like a football cake. Yeah, it's always decorated.
Okay.
And candles.
I'm going to move on to our live questions quickly because we don't have a lot of time left and we've got so many. So let's begin at the most recent ones first. Kelly's saying, if I remember correctly, Neil was in Myanmar, Burma once. I was indeed, and it was lovely. Did you find anything tasty or nothing? Every single thing I ate was delicious. I did not have a bad meal. From simple breakfast up to full going out to restaurants, everything was fantastic. I love Burmese food. Okay. This is an impossible question to answer, but I'm going to put you on the spot. Is there an English city? Okay, let's not say a city. Is there a part of England you think that has the best food? And is the food quite different in different parts of the country? Chris, what would you say?
That is a really difficult question.
I know.
No, I don't know the answer. Okay. Because we don't have the same differences in different parts of the country that other countries have. You know, if you go to Italy, then the food in the north of Italy is very different from the food in the south of Italy. And but I don't, and you know, it's the same if you go to India, then different parts of the country have very different dishes. But that's not really true of the UK. So probably I'd say Sunderland in the northeast, maybe.
Really, yeah. Chris, and what makes you say that?
Just, you know, I think that's probably what most people would say.
I think you're right. I mean, there are regional variations, but they're not as clear as they are. Like examples you gave there were great, India and Italy. I mean, you know exactly by what you're eating where you are in these countries. That's not really the same in the UK, I think. Claire, anything you'd say on this?
I think it's got to be a big city just because you get the variety there. So London, you can get food from all over the world in the restaurants there. And same in Manchester, I think.
Okay. Keeping on the topic of big, Saeed is asking, why do British people have big breakfasts? Well, let's clear this up first of all. Do British people have big breakfasts, do you think?
I don't think so. I think people just have a bit of toast, don't they? Or cereal, most people.
I usually just have coffee. A liter of coffee and I'm ready to start the day. Chris?
Sorry, what was the question? I'm just looking for...
Well, first of all, this is based on the idea of the English breakfast or the Scottish breakfast or the Irish breakfast or whatever else that goes with that, I guess. But do people have big breakfasts in the UK generally?
I don't. I have a bowl of cereal, exactly the same cereal every day, and 3 or 4, maybe 5 cups of tea.
So I mean, we do love, like, maybe on a Sunday or something, or if we're away, you know, on holiday or something, we do love a big breakfast, perhaps a big cooked breakfast, but it's not often. So that's the thing there. Okay. Let's move on. This is not a food question, but it's one we can answer in 2 seconds, so I'll just do it anyway. Mohammed's asking, when we teach English, do we say I'm an English teacher or I'm a teacher of English? I would say there's absolutely no difference between the two in meaning at all. Teacher of English perhaps is a little more formal. What would you say, Claire?
Same. So I normally say I'm an English teacher, I think, but they both work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Lots of... I'm not quite sure where some of the comments come from now. I guess...
It's a good comment.
Yep, scones. Well, if you like that one, this next one is even better.
I don't like that one.
Okay. I'm just seeing if there's any more here. Lots of people commenting on fish and chips and so on within that. Okay. Bear with me just for a moment. Good Boy's asking, any Indian food? I'm glad you asked that, because that's something that we do talk about in the course, isn't it?
Yeah.
Chris or Claire, which of you would like to talk a little bit about that?
Can I just say this is the food you should have in London. I was going to say go to Brick Lane, which is in the east end of London, and have the food. It's Bangladeshi food there, isn't it, mainly?
Oh, yeah, Bangladeshi, yeah.
It's amazing.
But it's a whole street of just restaurant after restaurant, all different and great. Mm-hmm. And all good prices as well, which is something that matters a lot for me when I'm eating. okay. Dastan Tarek asking, have you tasted Iraqi cuisine? I don't think I have. Have either of you?
Yes, I have. Uh-huh. I had, is it dolma, which is a lot kind of stuffed vegetable stuff with rice. I had some delicious fish, but in an Iraqi restaurant. Really nice.
Sounds great. I've not had it.
Tell us more, Dastan. What's your favourite?
Okay, Kelly's question. What is pub grub? What does that mean normally? That's a good question, because of course grub is like a slang word for food, but when we say pub grub, we have in our minds, I think, certain specific kind of common pub meals, don't we?
Chips.
So what would you kind of think? No?
Mainly chips.
Mainly.
Usually something with fish and chips, certainly, is a kind of pub
pie
grub.
Pie and chips, fish and chips. And
things
chips.
Like that, yeah.
So things that are quite heavy meals, really, and things that, to be honest, they're not high haute cuisine, are they? They're quite sort of heavy traditional British food, gammon and chips and pie and chips and something and chips,
curry as well,
and you can
get curry and rice and chips probably in the pub. English breakfast as well. You get an all-day breakfast. That's quite common in the pub.
Yeah. But yeah, generally, that's what we mean. Things that, you know, you can go to lots of different pubs and they'll all have these things on the menu kind of thing. So that's very common. And the second question is the difference between beer and ale. That's actually quite a difficult question to answer here. Ale is just another type of beer. And it is just to do with the process and the ingredients and so on for that. So maybe we'll add a link.
Yeah,
in
for a some of the things. A ploughman's lunch. Do we talk about a ploughman's lunch on the course?
We don't, but we should.
I do like a ploughman's lunch. What's a ploughman's lunch? Well, let's let's start at the beginning and explain what's a ploughman.
Oh, what have I started? Okay, so ploughing is something that a farmer does in a field where you turn the soil. But the interesting thing, so a ploughman's lunch is things that you don't cook. It's all things that the farmer could take into the field with him or with her to eat when it gets to lunchtime. So there's usually some pork pie. There's usually a pickled onion, some meat. There's some salad usually these days. Anything else?
Cheese.
Pickled
cheese
onion.
Cheese and bread. Perhaps.
Did you mention
bread? Yeah, so not a cooked meal, but things that the farmer can take out into the field for lunch.
Okay.
Traditionally, but it was invented in the 1960s.
Was it really? I didn't know.
It was by a marketing man. It was. It didn't exist before that. Oh. It was the cheese is the other thing, because it was the cheese marketing people who invented it in the 1960s.
You've ruined the romance of the ploughman's life.
But since then, it's been very traditional.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, yeah. It's been traditional since 1968.
Yusuf is inviting us to Egypt, which makes me very happy.
Oh,
Kushari, a mix of rice and pasta and other delicious ingredients.
Yeah.
Okay. Here's one, a very quick one, because we were talking about this just yesterday. Chris, have you ever tried Brazilian food?
Yeah, Rodolfo, yes, I have tried Brazilian food and it's fantastic. Now, Claire is vegetarian, so Claire, can you just cover your ears for a moment? Rodolfo, the meat in Brazil is fantastic. The restaurants where, you know, they just keep bringing you more and more fantastic meat until you can't eat any more meat at all. It's just fantastic, delicious.
I don't know how you say it. Was it churrascaria or something?
There's churrascaria, there's rodizio as well. It's rodizio Argentinian. I can't remember.
Yeah, So this is not a good conversation for Claire, being a vegetarian. But yes, me too. I just love that endless supply of delicious grilled and cooked and marinated meat. Mm. Apologies to all our vegetarian viewers.
I'm not afraid of meat. It's okay. I think there's probably lots of Brazilian food that's not meaty as well. I'd like to try.
Well, there is. There's
lots of beans, isn't there?
And... well, there's feijoada, which does have meat in it, but that's a black bean stew.
Mm. Oh, yeah. That'd be
like, I'd like to try that.
Fantastic.
Well, Rodolfo can tell us in the comments maybe about the variation. Okay, we're going to have to finish now. I'm just going to quickly scroll through and Katarzyna's answering to Kelly's question. Ale is just a light beer. Yeah, kind of. It can be a lower alcohol kind of beer for that. But there we go. Darren's given an answer. But I was going to share a link, but Darren's done it for us. It's produced by top fermentation, a process in which the yeast ferments at a warmer temperature and settles at the top of the beer. Okay. And it does result in a different kind of taste and, I guess, what would you call it? Experience. Okay, right, we have to finish now, unfortunately. I could stay here all day and do this, but I'm not allowed to. But I have to put this one in last. Are English people fond of pastries? Now, this is a good question. I just want to talk about this a little, because pastries, when you say pastries in plural like that, to me, it tends to suggest like Danish pastries and sweet cake type
sweet
ones.
Things, yeah.
And I love pastry and I love, you know, everything in pastry, but I'm not so keen on the sweet ones, but I love pies and pasties and, anything, empanadas. But what would you say, Claire? Are English people fond of pastries? Let's start with the sweet ones.
Yes. Yeah. Like apple turnover, which is like a pocket filled with sweet apple sauce. Delicious.
How do you make an apple turnover? Come on, Chris. You know you want to say.
I have no idea. I know how to make a Swiss roll. But no, I'm with Neil. I prefer the savory pastries. We need to put a link up to Greg's so just people can see. So Greg's is a shop in the UK. It's very popular for people to buy lunch in Greg's. And everything they sell is kind of the same colour. Pastry coloured.
I have to say, and I don't want to start an advertising thing, but you know, their vegan sausage roll is absolutely delicious.
Yeah, it's true. That's true. It's good.
That's okay. Go on, answer me. How do you make an apple turnover?
It's I don't know, Neil. How do you make an apple turnover?
is that you push it down a hill? Is that the one? No.
That's how you make a Swiss roll.
Okay, you can make a Swiss roll and an apple turnover at the same time. It's great. Okay, right. We have to stop there.
Finish on a high.
It's been great hearing from you all. We've got some recipes shared with us there, some lovely comments. It's been great in here about what you like, what you don't like, and all the things that you've eaten this week and everything else. Let's just finish up very quickly. Claire, a final word about the course and stuff and to tell people how to get there and what to do.
And go to the link that will be posted right now in the chat and join us to talk more about all of these things and tell us about food in your country.
Okay. Chris, any last word?
This has been great fun. Thank you for all of your comments. You've really made me laugh today with all of your comments and suggestions. And it's great to hear about what you're eating. And I hope we can continue the conversation on the course.
I'm going to finally eat my lunch now, which is a cold sausage and brown sauce on toast. It was hot when we started, but never mind. Okay. Thank you for all your questions and bye for now.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.